My name is Peter Chun. I'm the Vice President of the American Constitution Society. This is the official Constitution Day event for IIT and Chicago Kens. We are very thrilled and honored to have Professor Heyman, who is a terrific torts and criminal law teacher, professor, and also a First Amendment scholar. And he recently, or he is about to publish a law review article in the West Virginia Law Review entitled, I believe, "The Conservative Libertarian Turn in First Amendment Jurisprudence." And so that is going to be the topic of today's discussion. And Professor Heyman will kick it off with about 20 minutes of discussion on his thesis. And Professor Schmidt, who is also one of our distinguished scholars at our school, will be giving a 5-minute response. And then after that, it's on us to keep the discussion going and talk about these issues. So without further ado, Professor Heyman.
Thanks very much, Peter. It's a real honor and pleasure to participate in our school's observance of Constitution Day. And I want to thank Peter and the American Constitution Society and Professor Schmidt for putting this event together. This afternoon, I want to talk with you about some recent developments in the law of the First Amendment and also constitutional law more generally. Our constitutional order is founded on principles of liberty and equality and democracy, but the Constitution sets forth those principles only in a broad outline, and it leaves a lot of room for interpretation. So the history of American constitutionalism has been an ongoing struggle between competing understandings of the Constitution and of the ways in which it embodies those basic values. From the New Deal through the 1960s, the Supreme Court often read the Constitution in a liberal or progressive manner. But since that time, most of the folks who've been appointed to the court have been conservatives, and as a result, the Supreme Court has gradually moved toward a more conservative view of the Constitution. But I want to stress that this view is not a monolithic one. In some cases, the justices have taken a traditional conservative position. What I mean by that is a position that stresses the authority of government to maintain law and order and to promote traditional moral and social values. So in line with this view, you have decisions that reaffirm the constitutionality of capital punishment, limit the right to privacy, permit a closer relationship between church and state. But conservative jurisprudence also has a second strand, which I want to call conservative libertarianism. This view holds that the Constitution should be interpreted to promote individual freedom and to limit the authority of government. This view has led to decisions in recent years that expand constitutional protections for property rights, recognize an individual right to own guns, and cut back on the welfare state and the regulatory power of the federal government. These developments are well known, but I think that less attention has been paid to the ways in which conservative judges have reshaped First Amendment jurisprudence. As I'm going to show here too, they've often taken a libertarian stance. Of course, Exhibit A here is the Citizens United case, in which a majority declared that business corporations have the same First Amendment rights as natural persons, including a right to spend unlimited sums to influence the outcome of elections. But I think you can see the conservative libertarian trend also in some other areas, such as decisions that strike down restrictions on hate speech and pornography. In all of these cases, conservative judges have used the First Amendment to erect a barrier against regulation that seeks to promote liberal or progressive values. Of course, decisions like these clearly align with the political attitudes of the justices, both liberal and conservative. But I think that the phenomenon is more complex than that. So in some major cases, conservatives have voted to protect speech that clearly they strongly disliked. And the best example of this is Texas against Johnson, in which Justices Antonin Scalia and Anthony Kennedy provided the two critical votes for holding flag burning to be protected by the First Amendment. So in my view, the conservative libertarian approach can't be understood solely in terms of the justices' political inclinations or partisan commitments. Instead, I'm going to argue that this approach also reflects a deeper political and constitutional theory that's based on distinctive understandings of concepts like liberty, equality, and democracy. This afternoon, I want to explain we want to explore the conservative libertarian approach to the First Amendment and explain why I believe it to be flawed. I'm going to begin by sketching the basic theory that underlies this approach. Second, I want to show how it applies to constitutional law in general. Third, I'll discuss how it's been used in the First Amendment area. Fourth, I want to talk about some of the problems that I see with this approach. And finally, I want to briefly outline an alternative way of understanding the First Amendment. And I want to do this all in 20 minutes, so hang on to your hats. Let me start with the basic theory that underlies the conservative libertarian approach. Of course, you wouldn't expect to see this theory always spelled out in judicial opinions. But I think that it's at least implicit in these opinions, and then does a lot to explain the results that they reach. At the core of this theory is a conception of the individual. In accord with classical liberal theorists like John Locke, conservative libertarians see individuals as free, equal, and independent. Individuals should be free to do as they like, as long as they don't injure others. They have no connections with other people, except for the ones that they voluntarily establish. Following the German philosopher G.W.F. Hegel, I'm going to call this theory one of separate or exclusive individuality. That is, a view that sees individuals as sharply distinct from and often opposed to one another. On this view, society is basically an aggregation of individuals who pursue their own self-interest through competition or cooperation in the marketplace. As for the state, conservative libertarians have a deeply ambivalent attitude toward it. So on the one hand, people need the state to protect them against one another, as well as to protect society against foreign threats. But on the other hand, the state itself poses a great danger to freedom. This is where constitutionalism comes in. A major function of the Constitution on this view is to protect the negative liberty of the people against the government. The Constitution does this partly by expressly protecting rights, but also by means of the separation of powers and the division of authority between the federal government and the states. But of course, everything turns on how the Constitution is interpreted. Conservative libertarians believe that if the Constitution is to protect liberty, then it has to be viewed as a relatively fixed document, and interpretation has to be as objective as possible. It follows that courts must follow the original understanding of the Constitution, or at least must be strongly constrained by history and tradition. Now let me sketch some of the constitutional decisions that flow from this conservative libertarian view. And I've tried to list them in the handout that you have. And if anybody doesn't have a copy of the handout, maybe Peter would hand it to you. When I think of myself as a separate individual, then one of my deepest fears is that I'm going to be attacked by other people. So for this reason, conservative libertarians place a lot of emphasis on the right to self-defense. And I think this accounts for the Supreme Court's decision in District of Columbia against Heller, where Justice Scalia ruled that the Second Amendment is primarily about an individual right to self-defense and not about a collective right of citizens to have a well-regulated militia. After life and liberty, the most important right that private individuals have is to property. During the Lochner era, the Supreme Court invoked the Due Process Clause of the 14th Amendment to give strong protection to economic rights. In recent years, a number of conservative libertarians have sought to rehabilitate this position, including scholars like Richard Epstein and Randy Barnett, who used to teach here, and judges like Janice Rogers Brown of the D.C. Circuit. So far, interestingly, they haven't had any takers on the Supreme Court, in part because originalists like Scalia and Clarence Thomas are deeply skeptical of that substantive due process. But in a series of cases, the conservative justices have made an effort to reinvigorate provisions like the Takings Clause of the Fifth Amendment as a protection for property rights. Now, for conservative libertarians, one of the greatest threats to freedom comes from the federal government. In a series of cases, the majority has imposed limits on the Commerce Clause, which is Congress's broadest source of power. The most recent of these decisions, of course, is the Obamacare case, National Federation of Independent Business against Sebelius, in which five justices ruled that Congress could not use the commerce power to compel individuals to buy health insurance. The conservatives have also sought to rein in the modern state from another direction, by rejecting the notion that individuals have affirmative rights to public services or benefits. In DeShaney against Winnebago County, the court ruled that states don't even have a constitutional duty to protect their citizens against private violence. In the words of Judge Richard Posner, decisions like this stand for the proposition the quote, "The Constitution is a charter of negative rather than positive liberties," unquote. You can also see the conservative libertarian view at work in the equal protection area. For example, in cases like Gratz against Bollinger and Parents Involved against Seattle, the conservative justices have used a formal conception of equality or colorblindness to limit the government's ability to use race-conscious measures to combat inequality. Finally, I think you can see the conservative libertarian view on display in the biggest case from last term, that's Burwell against Hobby Lobby, in which the majority ruled that family-owned corporations have a right to religious liberty that entitles them to deny contraceptive coverage to their female employees. I think this is a perfect example of the justices using a libertarian approach to protect traditional moral values. So now let's talk about how the conservative libertarian view plays out in the First Amendment area. One of the path-breaking cases is called American Booksellers Association against HUDNA. It was decided by the Seventh Circuit right here in Chicago in 1985. The case involved a feminist anti-pornography ordinance that was drafted by Catherine McKinnon and Andrea Dworkin, and that was later adopted by the Indianapolis City Council. In HUDNA, the court struck down this law in an opinion by Judge Frank Easterbrook. Remarkably, Easterbrook began by conceding that pornography causes all the serious harms that McKinnon and Dworkin said that it did, from sexual violence and workplace discrimination to social and political subordination. But Easterbrook went on to assert that the very purpose of the First Amendment is to protect the power of speech to shape people's thoughts and actions, no matter how much harm that might cause. According to Easterbrook, if we allow the government to adopt laws to influence the way that people are socialized, then that would, quote, leave the government in control of all the institutions of culture, the great censor and director of which thoughts are good for us. Easterbrook insisted that under the First Amendment, the law has to remain neutral in the cultural struggle between those who see women as equal citizens and those who see them as mere sexual objects to be dominated. Because the ordinance took sides in the struggle, Easterbrook held that it violated one of the most basic principles of First Amendment law, and that is the rule that government may not discriminate against speech because of the viewpoint that it expresses. A few years later, in 1992, Justice Scalia used similar reasoning in a case called RAV against City of St. Paul, which involved a ban on cross-burning and other forms of hate speech. According to Scalia, the First Amendment does not allow the government to adopt even very narrow laws that are targeted at hate speech, because of the danger that those laws are really meant to impose political correctness by banning the expression of racist ideas. So now let's talk a little bit about the Citizens United case, which was decided 4 years ago. In several earlier decisions, the court had said that the government could prevent corporations from using resources amassed in an economic marketplace to obtain an unfair advantage in a political marketplace. In Citizens United, Justice Kennedy and his conservative colleagues overruled those cases, and instead held that corporations have the same First Amendment rights that individuals do, and that they may spend as much money as they want to influence elections. Earlier this year, you may have seen that there was a case called McCutcheon against FEC, where the majority went further and struck down a limit on the amount that wealthy donors can contribute to political parties and to candidates across the country. The dissenters warned that the decision would open the floodgates for money in politics even wider. But in his plurality opinion, Chief Justice John Roberts maintained that the First Amendment gives individuals the right to participate in the political process by making contributions, and that this right can't be restricted simply because Congress or even Republican general believes that it will damage our democracy or drown out the voices of other citizens. The final decision I want to mention is Boy Scouts of America against Dale. In that case, Chief Justice William Rehnquist held that the state of New Jersey violated the First Amendment freedom of association when it told the Scouts that they couldn't exclude individuals based on sexual orientation. So if you take these five cases, HUDNA, RAV, Citizens United, McCutcheon, and Dale, I think that you can discern some of the main features of the conservative libertarian approach to the First Amendment. First, these decisions understand the positive functions of free speech in line with the general theory that I discussed earlier. Free speech is seen as a right that allows separate individuals to pursue their own private interests and desires, as in HUDNA, or their moral and religious values, as in Dale. The conservative justices also see free speech as vital to democratic self-government. But their position differs from the classical view that was articulated by Justice Louis Brandeis and by the philosopher Alexander Micheljohn. Brandeis and Micheljohn saw political speech as a way for citizens to engage in democratic deliberation about the common good. By contrast, the conservative justices regard public debate as a marketplace in which individuals and groups use their resources to promote their own private interests and beliefs. These five decisions also reflect conservative libertarian theory in the second way. For the most part, they see free speech as a form of negative liberty. So for example, in HUDNet and RFE, the conservatives don't claim that pornography or hate speech has any positive value. Instead, they stress the dangers posed by government censorship. A third and final point is this. For conservative libertarians, the danger to freedom comes not only from the government, but also from the broader society. In HUDNet and RFE and Dale, the majority uses the First Amendment to protect individuals against the imposition of social norms, like equality, or dignity, or respect for others. The conservative judges treat the enforcement of these norms as a form of political correctness, or what they call thought control. It's no accident, then, that some of the leading cases involve expressions such as racist hate speech or misogynistic pornography. For conservative libertarians, one of the crucial functions of the First Amendment is precisely to protect speech that's antisocial in nature. So now let me turn to a critique of this approach to the First Amendment. I want to highlight five problems with that. First, I think that decisions like Citizens United and McCutcheon draw too close a connection between free speech and property rights. Libertarians like Professor Epstein argue that the court's approach is consistent with the Lockean natural rights theory that strongly influenced the Constitution. But Locke saw a basic distinction between inalienable rights, like speech, thought, and belief, which were beyond the power of the state altogether, and rights like economic liberty and property, which were subject to regulation for the common good. Locke also warned against the danger that private interests would come to dominate public decision-making. So when it comes to speech and property rights, I believe that the conservative libertarian approach turns out to be unpersuasive, even in its own terms. The second problem with this approach is that it gives too much protection to speech that abuses or degrades other people. As I've said, conservative libertarianism sees people as separate individuals who have no inherent connection with one another. When viewed in this way, the individual is a subject who tends to see himself as the center of the world. Although he may choose to cooperate with some people, he may regard others as mere objects to be used for his own purposes, as with the violent and degrading pornography at HUDNet, or as enemies to be dominated or destroyed, as with the hate speech in RFD. Now, I want to be clear about this. I'm not suggesting that conservative libertarians approve of this sort of expression, but they do hold that it has to be protected in order to guard the selfhood of the speaker against the imposition of social norms. I would argue that this position is actually self-defeating, because abusive and degrading speech not only injures the personality of the targets, it also interests the speaker's own personality by undermining his humanity and his relationship with others. The third problem I want to raise is whether the conservative libertarian approach is internally coherent. As the label that I've given it suggests, this approach represents a sort of fusion between libertarianism on the one hand and social conservatism on the other. These two strands of conservative thought are united in their opposition to what they regard as liberal legal orthodoxy. But there's also a deep tension between them, because they seem to be rooted in very different views of the social world. Libertarians see society as an association of individuals whose freedom must be paramount, while social conservatives view society as a larger whole, which should promote not only the freedom of individuals, but also their moral well-being, as well as the good of the community. The tension between these two positions is not apparent in the free speech cases that we've talked about so far, where regulation comes from the left. But the conflict clearly emerges in other situations, such as internet pornography or violent video games, where regulation comes from elsewhere on the political spectrum. In these cases, some justices, like Kennedy, take a libertarian position, while others, like Samuel Alito, take a social conservative one. The underlying problem is that, in the end, I think the conservative justices see both individuality and community as important values, but they don't have any clear way to resolve conflicts between these values. The fourth problem that I want to mention has to do with neutrality. The conservative judges insist that when the state regulates speech, it has to adhere to a rigorous ideological neutrality and they often use this principle to strike down regulation from the left. But from what I've said, it should be clear that the conservative libertarian view fails to live up to its own standards of neutrality. I think HUDNet is a perfect example. In that case, Judge Easterbrook ruled that the state could restrict sexual material on the ground that it violated traditional standards of morality, but not on the ground that it undermined the equality of women. Likewise, in a recent case called United States against Stevens, Chief Justice Roberts declared that the only categories of unprotected speech are those that have historically been unprotected. This position is tailor-made for striking down progressive regulations of speech while upholding regulations that promote traditional values. Here's the last problem. In contrast to the cases that I've discussed, the conservative judges take a much more restrictive view when it comes to the First Amendment rights of certain groups, like prisoners, or public school students, or government employees. In these cases, the conservative judges see individuals not as free, equal, and independent, but rather as subject to the authority of the institutions in which they study, work, or are incarcerated. Okay, so I've thrown a lot of stuff at the conservative libertarian view. You might say, so to how should we think about freedom of expression? So I want to briefly sketch an alternative view, which I'm going to call a liberal humanist theory of the First Amendment. This view is liberal in the sense that it places a high value on individual freedom. It's humanist in the sense that it seeks to promote the fullest realization of human nature and the good. I think the problems with the conservative libertarian view can be traced back to its theory of the self. This theory holds that we're all separate and independent individuals who have no inherent connections with each other. Of course, we are separate individuals, but we're also social beings. We find our identity and fulfillment not only in the development of our individuality, but also through our social relationships and our participation in community. On this view, the ideal is really not separate or exclusive individuality, but rather individuality in community or in relationship with others. I think free speech should be understood in this context. Speech is not only subjective, it's also intersubjective and social. What I mean by that is, when I engage in discussion, I'm not merely expressing my own thoughts and feelings, I'm also communicating with other people, forming a relationship with them. This relationship can be based on a lot of things, such as a common interest in music or politics, or whether the Bears will manage to make it to the playoffs this year. But at bottom, the relationship that's formed through communication is always based on mutual recognition. That is, individuals can communicate with one another only if they regard each other as intelligent beings, that is, as persons. For this reason, I would argue that the right to free speech carries with it a duty to recognize the personhood of others, as well as the rights that flow from that status. It follows that free speech doesn't give you a blank check to invade the rights of other people. Speech that infringes those rights without adequate justification is wrongful and shouldn't receive constitutional protection. And I think this is actually a principle that was widely accepted at the time that the First and the 14th Amendments were adopted. But here's the $64,000 question. How can we tell what those rights are? On the view that I'm taking, rights are rooted in respect for human freedom and dignity. We can determine what rights people have by exploring what it means to be a free person in different spheres of human life, including the external world, the inner realm of thought and feeling, the social and political domain, and what the Supreme Court has called the sphere of intellect and spirit. The right to free speech can be understood on all of these levels, but in each case, the principles that support free speech also support other basic rights that deserve protection under the law. In this way, we can determine when speech should be protected by the First Amendment and when it shouldn't be. I've tried to capture this view on the reverse side of your handout, which situates free speech within a broader framework of rights. So to start with the first row, one way to see free speech is as a form of external freedom, or the right to control your own mind and body. To a large extent, this is how conservative libertarians see freedom of speech. At the same time, other individuals also have a right to external freedom, including a right to personal security or freedom from violence. Likewise, the community has a right to the public peace. Speech violates these rights when it constitutes an assault, a threat of violence, fighting words, or incitement. A second rationale for free speech is that it's essential for individual self-realization. But the same thing is true of other rights, such as emotional well-being, privacy, personal dignity, and reputation. For this reason, the law should be allowed to impose some restraints on intentional infliction of emotional distress, invasion of privacy, insulting words, and defamation. A third justification for free speech is the one associated with Brandeis and Mikhailchuk. On this view, the First Amendment protects the ability of citizens to engage in democratic self-government. But of course, other people also have rights of citizenship and participation, which can be violated by certain forms of speech. There's a lot more that could be said about the handout, but this should give you a sense of the approach that I'm going to take. As a quick illustration, consider the problem of funeral picketing. As you all know, in recent years, the Westboro Baptist Church has picketed thousands of funerals across the country, holding up signs emblazoned with homophobic slurs, with slogans like, "Thank God for dead soldiers," "You're going to hell," or "God hates America." In Snyder against Phelps, the Supreme Court acknowledged that this picketing causes great pain to the mourners, but ruled that the picketing is political speech that's protected by the First Amendment. This opinion was rooted by Chief Justice Roberts, and I think it's consistent with the conservative libertarian view. This case would look very different from a liberal humanist perspective. Westboro's speech is meant to target the people who are attending the funeral. By intentionally interfering with their ability to mourn their loved ones, the speech invades their rights to privacy, dignity, and emotional well-being, as well as their religious or spiritual freedom. On the other side of the balance, the picketing certainly expresses Westboro's religious beliefs and its attitude towards America, but I don't think that anybody should have a right to force such views of the mourners at a funeral. And if church members want to communicate with the public at large, then they have a lot of ways to do this that doesn't have such a severe impact on mourners. So for these reasons, I believe that reasonable restrictions on funeral picketing should be upheld under the First Amendment. The liberal humanist approach would also lead to different results in the other First Amendment cases that we've discussed. And since I'm almost out of time, I don't want to discuss them in detail now, although I'm happy to talk about them in the discussion period if you want. For now, let me just say that on this view, the First Amendment should not be understood as largely about the protection of abusive or antisocial speech. If it can be shown that some forms of hate speech or pornography cause serious injury to others, as Easterbrook thought, then there may be a good case for regulating it. As for campaign finance, the First Amendment should be interpreted to allow for reasonable regulation to protect democratic deliberation from the impact of unlimited spending by wealthy individuals and corporations. And finally, the Boy Scouts decision seems to rest on an idea of exclusive individuality and a corresponding notion that the right to freedom of association, like the right to property, is essentially a right to exclude others. If we understand individuality in more inclusive terms, as something that flourishes through relationship with others, then I think there's a much stronger case for telling Boy Scouts that they can't discriminate based on sexual orientation. Thanks very much. I look forward to hearing your views and those of Professor Schmidt.
Discussion. I've had a pleasure seeing Professor Hayman's project evolve over a year, I think. And I have to say, the last version I saw was about a 230-page law review article. I'm only exaggerating a little bit, it was really long. So it's just impressive not only to see the work come out, but to see it condensed down. I just have a few comments to make, and then we can open up the discussion. And I'm going to break my comments into a quibble, a question, and a compliment. The quibble. I do think Professor Hayman's characterization of libertarianism is perhaps an accurate portrayal of a certain strand of libertarianism, maybe hardcore libertarianism, the idea of individuals out there in society just trying to fight for themselves on their own, and this being a basic principle of libertarianism. It just seems to be that libertarianism, as it operates in society today, with a pretty powerful resonance among large swaths of American people, that probably wouldn't really be the characterization of libertarianism that many of them would embrace. I think the factor that Professor Hayman alludes to, but I think needs to be maybe more boldly highlighted in their definition of libertarianism, is yes, individualism, but more importantly, just skepticism toward government. And the idea of the importance of social relations that he highlights at the end of his paper with his contribution to his own view about how we should view the First Amendment, I don't think it's necessarily antithetical to how a lot of libertarians might view proper social relations. They would just say, this is for non-governmental institutions. in our society to create these kind of connections. It's not that we don't want to have community connections. Again, the state is skeptical toward the state being the primary institution that is creating or encouraging these institutions. And that's where I think this conservative libertarian versus kind of jurisprudence really gets a lot of traction. So that's my quibble. Small. Question. So the thing I wonder as I read this is what explains this transformation? And I think it is worth stepping back just a half step and thinking about the historical trajectory of the First Amendment. And I think once we do that, we're going to realize that there is, you know, sort of the obvious explanation for why this happened, but also it becomes maybe more predictable and perhaps less alarming. So if you want to look at modern First Amendment jurisprudence, we can basically break it down into three large periods. The first period would be in the first third to half of the 20th century. And this is when we actually see groups who support what we call the Watney era, right, sort of libertarian sentiment, anti-government regulation, many oftentimes connected with conservatism, starting to embrace First Amendment principles as a way to just get government off their back. And they also embrace right, the contract principles and anti-economic regulation principles. But First Amendment principles were part of their repertoire, and they created this alliance with labor groups, liberal groups, who saw the First Amendment as a way to further their own liberal interests. So you actually had this sort of strange bedfellow dynamic early in the 20th century, which really gave birth to a bipartisan commitment to the modern First Amendment. The First Amendment just really didn't have much of a presence in our legal culture before the 20th century. So that's stage one. Again, it's a marriage of convenience. I wouldn't say it's necessarily progressive or conservative. It's this mix of the two. The next stage, the one many of us are familiar with, would be the War on Court era, in which the First Amendment was used primarily to further progressive social issues. I'm not going to lose this in the beginning of this paper. Absolutely correct. If you look at the major First Amendment decisions of this period, most of them were advancing what we would call liberal progressive causes. And then that brings us to the modern era, the Rehnquist-Roberts-Court period, in which we see this transformation which Professor Haynes identified. And I think he really nails the diagnosis exactly right. We do see the First Amendment being used as a tool to advance conservative interests. But I will say, just look at its historical trajectory, it's predictable. Right? The First Amendment has always been a tool to do something. Right. There is a basic principle of free speech that we should celebrate, and that's important. But just look at how it's been used. It's always been used for a purpose. And the fact that you have a conservative majority in the current court with powerful support in society at large, that they are using the First Amendment for these ends, again, it would be surprising for some reason it wasn't working out in this way. So I do think the First Amendment has always been a vehicle, a tool for other ends. But then I think the question is, well, what are these other ends? And Professor Haynes is exactly right to say these ends do have this conservative libertarian valence to them. So then I think the project really becomes a critique of conservative libertarianism. I don't think it's necessarily a critique of using the First Amendment for these ends. Because again, I think the First Amendment can be used for many purposes. And it should be used for different purposes. That's what constitutional principles that evolve over time, that's really what they should do. And this is, I think, where Professor Haynes really scores the critical points in his project, and that is as a critique. This is a compliment part. As a critique, I think he really nails some of the shortcomings of this particular approach to understanding society and the relationship of government and society to society. And not only does he offer a very powerful critique, but then he does the hard work of offering his alternative, the liberal humanist approach. Is both inspired and inspiring in the vision of the relationships between social relations, government, and the First Amendment. So this is where I'm going to leave it and open up the discussion, but I just urge you to think seriously about this challenge that Professor Haynes has laid out for us. Thank you.
Professor, you referred to libertarianism, and you said it was better defined as sort of skepticism towards the state. But I guess where I'm confused is why do they have skepticism towards the state? You know, is it because they believe that it doesn't voice what their beliefs are? In which case, it seems like it's because of sort of the corruption that maybe is could be addressed by issues that Citizens United and this sort of thing, in terms of unequal representation in the government, or is it because they they don't feel that, but they feel like the masses have spoken and doesn't, they don't agree with it, which basically seems to be more of a, seems to be more about their individual rights. So just why is there skepticism?
You want to take a first go at that?
No,
I took that question redirected to you.
No, so, I mean, so that's where the rubber hits the road for trying to analyze, is libertarianism something other than just conservatism or unhappiness with majoritarian politics? Right, so the idea of skepticism toward the state, I think you nailed the issue. Are you just skeptical toward the state when it doesn't represent what you want? So you're all on board with state power when it's doing what you want, but then it doesn't do what you want, and then you call the high principles and say the government should not be regulating at all. Right, so then the question is this actually a neutral principle of skepticism toward the state, or is it opportunistic? The principled argument would be that the government is just simply less responsive to the needs and demands of the people, and therefore government regulation is by definition a diminution of personal liberty and freedom. Right? So the very same constraints that might be put upon you by, say, your family, your community, or your church are just different when the government is doing it, because the government is more distant, the government is more of an other, whereas the institutions that you are okay with the constraints are institutions that you feel like they're actually more a part of you. But this is based on a premise of governments being there, individuals being there, and some sort of gap between them, which I don't think Mr. Naaman would challenge that very premise.
On your handout here, and I'm sure this isn't exhaustive, it seems to be Supreme Court decisions and then one Seventh Circuit decision. Have any of the other circuits gone closer to your liberal humanist view of where the First Amendment should be, or are they constrained by the Supreme Court?
Yeah, it's very interesting. I think it turns a lot on the particular issue that I was talking about. One example that comes to mind is that I don't know if you all have seen these cases involving sort of anti-gay t-shirts in high schools. There's one in the Seventh Circuit, there was one in the Ninth Circuit. This is a situation where gay rights groups might be having something that they call a day of silence in high school, gay students and sympathizers with them will maintain silence during the day and try to dramatize the way that they think that they're going to be silenced by the society. And in a couple of situations, some conservative, sometimes conservative Christian students have worn t-shirts. A Seventh Circuit case involved one that said, don't be gay, be happy. The Ninth Circuit case had a quotation from St. Paul's letter to the Romans, sort of denouncing homosexuality. In the Ninth Circuit case in particular, there was this kind of split between people who were more on the liberal end of the spectrum and more conservative end. And interestingly, in that case, Judge Stephen Reinhardt, who in other respects is a very strong civil libertarian, nevertheless said, I think that this kind of speech, at least in high school setting, can be so damaging to gay students within the school that it is legitimate for the state to prohibit wearing a t-shirt like that. And a colleague of his, Alex Kaczynski, who's a conservative libertarian, so strongly dissented from this and argued that this expression should be protected. So that's one example that comes to mind of a circuit court decision that maybe approached the issue more along the lines that I would. And let me just stress, sort of as a final point here, that really what I'm talking about here is a balancing approach rather than some kind of notion that speech always ought to be restricted whenever it impinges on other values. I certainly don't think that at all, which is why the view that I'm presenting I see as a liberal, one that's meant to protect individual freedom. So what I'm urging is simply that the courts try to take seriously whatever the values are on the other side in the First Amendment equation, and then seriously balance the values to try to determine, on the whole, which position better protects our rights and protects human freedom and dignity. When we approach a case like the female picketing that way, I actually think these are pretty easy cases because the harm to the mourners is so great, and the protesters have such extensive other ways to promote their views.
I wonder what your response is to the quibble. I think
some libertarians would say, you know, the problem with government activity is that it's isolating, is that people say, well, the government will take care of it, the government will regulate this speech, and so I don't have the responsibility, and that's actually more isolating and less encouraging of a community that says, no, it's our responsibility to take care of this stuff.
Yeah, I think that's a very nice point, and I don't want, I guess I, in 20 minutes, I had to be pretty polemical, I guess, in the attitude I was taking towards the conservative libertarian view. I have to admit, even in the 230-page version, or whatever, it is, I agree with you that there's a lot to be said for this libertarian position, and I think that libertarians might sometimes be wanting to try to promote what they see as genuine community, rather than simply protecting the rights of isolated individuals. I would still wonder, though, about the sort of extreme skepticism and distrust of government, and I don't really understand where that would arise from in some kinds of cases. Right? There are certain kinds of cases where the government has a very strong self-interest in restricting speech. So whenever it tries to restrict speech that is critical of the government itself or of government officials, then I'm just as skeptical of government as anybody. I think that we all ought to be. And I think that this is a situation in which civil libertarians on all ends of the political spectrum can agree that the First Amendment should give very strong protection to speech that is anti-government speech or critical of government officials. But in situations like the Westboro example, where you have people who are violating the most basic norms of the community, you know, which say that that somebody who's burying a loved one is entitled to dignity and respect and not intrusions that really are unrelated to what's going on with them. In a situation like that, it would seem to me that if you have libertarians that are more community-minded, they probably would be much more open to the idea that the law should be able to provide some protection in that situation. So maybe one thing we need to think about a little bit is this idea of the government and to not see that as all situations where the government is restricting speech as being the same thing, distinguishing between situations where the speech is hostile to the government itself, situations where the government is really trying to do what it's supposed to do, which is to maintain some social order and harmony and to protect the rights of everybody involved.
I know a lot of personal cases from religion. There's a question of engagement, such as the right to engage in religious beliefs as well as disengage from religious beliefs. How does that tie into your idea of engagement with speech on the level of hate speech or violent pornography, the choice of the individual to engage with it or not engage with it, or when they're forced to engage with it because it's so pronounced or so open? Like the Westboro Baptist, you're forced to engage with their speech, whereas pornography, you're not forced to engage with it if you don't wish to.
Yeah, I think that's a great point. I think that would be very relevant to the way in which we want to think about these cases. I think that conservative libertarians tend to talk about free speech as simply a matter of the rights of the individual and often focusing on the speaker and their rights. And I agree with you that there are some situations in which the speaker or in which an individual is largely engaged in self-regarding activity. So somebody who's just sitting in their own home and watching something on the internet may not really be affecting other people for the most part. And situations like that, there would obviously be very strong arguments for protecting First Amendment rights in that situation. In other situations, the speaker is really trying to communicate with other people. That's true, as you say, in the Westboro situation. They're deliberately targeting the lawyers, and they make it very clear on their website and in the things that they say that what they're trying to do is to communicate with the people who go to the funerals. I think that in a situation where the speaker is trying to communicate, then we need to think about the situation more in terms of the rights of both parties and also whether the speaker is showing the minimum amount of respect towards the folks that they're communicating with, that meaningful communication is possible. I would say that in the Westboro case, there really is no meaningful communication. it's really just harassment. I guess we have time for one last question.
Just a question regarding the framing of the issue. Do you see it as a divide maybe along with political lines, ideological lines, or is this a tension between how we view individually ourselves as individuals against society? Is it a push back and forth, or is it removed from that?
I think there's a lot of ideology going on in the kinds of cases that I was describing. And I want to say I agree with Professor Schmidt entirely that it's not possible to exclude ideology from judicial decision making. For the very reason that the Constitution identifies basic principles or values, but doesn't get down to the brass tacks enough to say exactly how they should implement it. So I do agree with him that it's entirely legitimate for the conservative justices on the Supreme Court to interpret the Constitution in light of their vision. Of the individual and the society and the nature of our constitutional order. So I don't at all want to say that it's illegitimate on their part to do this, but I agree with your characterization that that what there is that sort of a deep disagreement going on in many of these cases between people who are on one side or the other of the political spectrum. And if nothing else, I think it's just helpful to identify the different views so that we can then start to think about what we think and maybe if there's some way to find common ground between these views. So thank you all so much for coming this afternoon. There's another.